In the second lecture, so we started to look at the dynamics of a liquid in infinite dimensions and in equilibrium. Okay, so we are considering dynamics that starts in equilibrium and stays in equilibrium at all times. So the Boltzmann distribution is stationary, and everything is a function of t minus t prime. And what we did was to derive two effective stochastic processes that have some memory function m. So there is a two-particle process. So the two-particle process, so you take two particles and you have two, each particle has a thermal bath made by the neighbors, and they interact. And it looks like this. So you have a mass term, a friction term, and then you have this memory term. So this is a friction term with memory. And then you have a noise, and you have the force. So the force is just the gradient of the pair potential. And this noise, so all these are vectors here in the dimensions. And this noise, so mu and nu are the components, the spatial components. So these different components are uncorrelated. And then the correlation function of the noise is precisely related by the fluctuation dissipation theorem to the friction. So you have a delta term that is the original white noise that you had. I mean, this describes your, if you have colloidal particles, this would be your solvent. And this is the noise, the correlation of the noise that is generated by the interaction with the other particles. So this R should start in some initial position R0 and with some velocity V0, but I forgot to stress the velocity part, but okay. It's a second order equation, so you have to specify the velocity. And then the memory function is just the force-force correlation. So what you have to do, so you start with some R0 and V0. So you take R0 from the G of R, and in infinite dimensions, G of R is just exponential of minus beta V. You take the velocity from the Maxwell distribution. There is a factor of 2, because these are two particles, and this is the relative velocity. So if each particle has a Maxwell, you can see that the relative velocity has twice the variance. There is a factor of 2. And then you have the force-force correlation. So yesterday I wrote it as average of f of t prime, but since m is a function of t minus t prime, I can choose t prime equal to 0 without loss of generality. And if I choose t prime equal to 0, this is just the f of, at the initial point. And then I have just to take the average of the force at time t. Okay. So this is a closed system of equations for m. So if I'm able to solve this, I get m. And then once I have m, I said, okay, I can look just to one particle. So if I look to just one particle, the position x of the particle has a very similar equation, except that there is no force now, because the force is included into m. And okay, here I put a square root of 2. There was no square root of 2 yesterday, but now I put a square root of 2 just to have the same. So this noise has the same statistics as this noise, because there is a factor 1/2 here, because we divided by 2/1 anyway. So this noise has the same statistics as this noise, has the same correlation, but okay, they are independent, okay? Just they have the same statistics. And I told you, if you want as an exercise, or if you want, you can check the book. From this, you can derive an equation for the mean square displacement of the particle, d. So d of t is the mean square displacement. And it satisfies this equation that is exactly the same as the one of x, except that instead of the noise, you have a constant. Okay, and then from this, also you can do this as an exercise, if you assume that there is diffusion, so you assume that d of t is linear at long times, and this calligraphic d is the diffusion constant, then you can easily show that the diffusion constant is given by t divided by zeta, that is the friction of the solvent, plus the integral of the memory. So if you have no memory, no interactions, you just recover t over zeta, that is the Bayer diffusion constant, and then the presence of this memory reduces the diffusion typically, because m is positive, so this integral is in general positive. Okay, so this is these are the equations that describe the dynamics of a liquid of particles in infinite dimensions in equilibrium. Now, what we want to do now is to check what happens when we solve these equations, and do we get the glass transition. So the first thing, you can solve the equations numerically. So Alessandro showed the picture in his short talk. So, okay, now you can I will make reference to section 3.3 of the book, where we discuss the dynamical glass transition. And so what happens? So you see, you have the density here, and you have the temperature in the potential. So these are the control parameters. So you can increase the density or reduce the temperature. I'm going to, for simplicity, I'm going to consider hard spheres. So in hard spheres, the temperature is not important, OK? You can, the potential is either 0 or infinity, so this temperature is irrelevant. And then you have a temperature in the velocity that you can scale and set to 1. It gives you the unit of time. So if you solve numerically the equations, what you get when you increase the density is something like this. The memory function behaves, OK, in our spheres, it's singular at short times, but we don't really care about that. So we get something like this in the liquid. Sorry for the, it's hard to draw a good line with the hand. And in the glass, we get something like this. So there is a plateau at long times at some finite value and infinity. So when you increase the density, you see that these things slows down. So it becomes slower and slower, and then you get, at some point, it doesn't relax to zero. If you take this memory and you put it in the equation for D, you can draw the mean square displacement. So the mean square displacement in the liquid is going to be something like this, let's say, or it can be faster or slower. But anyway, this is the liquid. And in the glass, you will get something like this. And you have a finite limit for the MSD. So here, it's going to behave like 2D times the diffusion constant times time. So you have diffusion. And in the glass, you don't have diffusion. And you can show that it's very easy. If the memory is infinite, this integral is divergent. The diffusion constant is zero, and you don't have diffusion. So, good. So this is what you get from the numerical solution. So can we say a bit more on this? On this glass transition, can we get it? A bit more easily than solving this? And the answer is yes. So there is a very simple ansatz you can make. So we are going to make an ansatz for the memory function. We are going to plug the ansatz into the equations, and we're going to get a simple equation for the plateau. And the ansatz is just to say, okay,
going from the liquid to the glass is discontinuous.
Yes, in the slow liquid you get something like this.
Okay.
It's a bit less pronounced that you can check Alessandro's poster. Anyway, yes, you get a discontinuous transition. So the assumption we are going to make is that M of T can be decomposed into a fast part plus the plateau. So we are going to say, okay, when we are in the glass phase, we have a finite limit M infinity, and then this MF is this part. Okay, so,
and this will decay to zero quickly.
Okay, over a finite time, let's say. So limit for T going to infinity of MF of T is zero. So if you put this into the equation, so first of all, let's put this into the equation for the mean. One thing, today I'm going to drop the mass, okay? So if you want, you can keep the mass, but today I'm going to drop, for simplicity, I'm going to drop all these things so you can forget all these terms that anyway don't play any role in the long time dynamics. So let's put these ansatz into the equation for D. So what do we get? We get something like this is going to be minus beta times the integral of M of T minus T prime fast times D dot of T, right? Minus beta m infinity. So when I put m here, I have m times d dot. So if I put m fast, I get the first term. If I put a constant for m, I just get the integral of d dot. So this is d of t minus d of 0. But d of 0 is 0, because the mean square displacement by construction is 0. So here I just get d of t. Right? And then I have plus 2 d t. So you see, already you see here, that now I get a kind of spring constant that is bringing back d to the origin. I get something like d dot equal to minus kd. So this will prevent the diffusion. So what happens at long times? At long times, if I'm in the glass, I'm assuming now I'm in the glass, right? So if I'm in the glass, d dot will go to 0. So this at long times, this term will go to 0. And this integral also goes to 0. Why? Because mf, so when t prime is close to t, mf is finite. But if t is large and t prime is close to t, then t prime is large. This is t prime. And d dot goes to 0. If t prime is close to 0, then this is finite, but this is 0. So the integral goes to 0. And I just end up with minus beta m infinity d infinity plus 2 dt equal to 0. So I can relate, so I get that the plateau of the mean square displacement is just given by 2d over beta square m infinity. Okay? So if I know the plateau of the memory function, I know also the plateau of the mean square displacement. The two objects are related. So now the next step is we want to get an equation for the plateau. There is a T here, yes. Sorry. So you have to, okay?
Just when you say that MF goes faster, it shouldn't go like a power law to the plateau.
No, to the power law is only at the critical point.
Here.
If you are away, I'm in the glass.
Okay.
So the small d is just dimensionality?
Yes, this is dimensional space. I will send, I mean, it's infinity, but we will scale. In a second, we are going to get rid of d by scaling everything. But for the moment, I'm working in, I'm assuming d is, I don't know, 1 million, but it's fixed. OK. Now,
How about if you only consider vibration mode?
If I consider?
Vibration mode.
You vibrations.
Have, you also have the vibration mode. So the particles are located at 1 minimum.
Uh-huh.
It's
yes, this is vibration, essentially.
Vibration, okay.
This term is going to be a vibrational term. It will be clear in a second. So let's maybe make a little bit of space. So what happens if I want to get an equation for m infinity? So I should now put these answers into the equation for r. Okay? So I get the same thing. So, okay, two things. The first thing is that I should decompose the noise. So the noise will have a fast part that depends on this delta plus the fast part of m. And then there is plus m infinity. But, so let's write it here. But so if I have a Gaussian that has a variance that is the sum of two terms, I can always write this as the sum of two Gaussians independent. Okay, such that, so these are two independent noises. The first one has this part as a variance, and the second has just m infinity over 2. I have the spatial. Okay, you see what I mean. So this will be constant because the variance is constant. And this one is going to be a function of time with a fast decaying correlation. And then the equation for r becomes, if I neglect again the mass, is going to be something like this.
And then I have minus degree, okay, let's write it as dv over dr. Then I have so I'm taking this equation, so I have this term. Here I have a fast term that I bring on the other side. Then I have to put m infinity. And then I get the integral between 0 and t of r dot. So I will get the minus beta over 2 times m infinity times r of t minus r of 0. Right? And then I get plus the noise psi infinity plus the fast term. Okay, so I have three terms here. I have a fast friction, and I have a fast noise, and these two are related by FDT. So I have a fast bath in equilibrium, and then I have another term, which is this, and this I can write this as minus dw over dr. So it's an effective potential, where w of r is just v of r, so the original potential. But then on top of that I have plus beta m infinity over 4 times r of t, sorry, r minus r0 square, and then I have minus the noise psi infinity dot r. So these are vectors, okay? So you see the effect of this infinite memory on the r is to add to the potential an harmonic term. So it's really the confinement of the particles because they are stuck in a glass. And then there is this little tilt because of this noise. Okay, so this is my effective potential. So you see that if the plateau of the memory is zero, then this term is zero and this term is zero. V of r goes to zero at infinity, so the so r can diffuse. But if m is there, then it will prevent r from diffusing.
Consciously?
Yes.
I didn't get why psi infinity is constant.
If you want, you can choose it to be a constant. You see, if I write psi in this way, and I assume that these two terms are independent, have zero mean, and the variance of this is the fast part, and the variance of this is a constant m infinity. If I take the variance of psi, I have the variance of the first plus the variance of the second, and that's what I want. So I can write it in this way. I could write it also in other ways, but
Psi infinity, it's not because the variance of psi infinity is constant.
No, you're right, I say the stupid thing. So it's just I can write it in this way.
Okay.
I could also write it in other ways, but this is convenient. If I write it in this way, then I can put psi in the potential, and this is the bath. This is the noise conjugated to the bath. So sorry. Yes?
So if you have a quenched disorder like that, and if you look in one realization, don't you have that there is a drift that goes, like is the particle moving into the direction as your force? So
this one?
Yeah. Like, I mean, if I take a realization of that.
A realization of psi.
Then the quenched case, don't I have something that seems to be that everything?
No, because this term is stronger. I mean, this will tilt the equilibrium position of the particle. So the particle is starting in R0, but because of the disorder that is this term, the equilibrium position is not exactly R0. It can be tilted a little bit, but the harmonic potential is always going to win. So you really have a spring. I mean, this thing is a spring, right?
Yes.
Just the equilibrium position of the spring depends on R0 and on this noise. But it's a spring, so you cannot go too far. Fine, so now you see, now I have a particle moving in a potential with a fast bath. So at long times,
it will equilibrate in the butt. So the probability of R at large times, of R of T at large times, is going to be exponential of minus beta W of R divided by the normalization, so the integral over R of E to the minus beta R prime. Okay? So if I want to compute the plateau, sorry, if I want to compute M at large times, so let's get rid of this term that anyway would average to 1. If I want the limit of T going to infinity, I need f of r0 dot f of r of t, but when t is large, this is going to equilibrate. So I get
this is a random probability.
This is, yes, sorry, let me write it properly. So this is going to be a p of r
conditional,
sorry. This is p of r given psi infinity and r0. And something else should be enough. Yes, that's it. It's a conditional probability. So exactly, so now my, sorry, I need to make space somewhere. So now my equation for M, let's draw. I don't need any more stuff. So what I get here is just that M infinity is rho over d integral over r0, then I have f of r0, and then I have the average of f of r of t at long time, so this is going to be the integral over r of e to the minus beta w of r times f of r divided by integral over r of e to the minus beta w of r, and w depends. Okay, W depends on R0 and psi infinity. So I have to average condition to these two things. And then I also need to integrate over d psi over, let's write it in this way, d psi infinity, where this is a Gaussian measure with variance psi infinity square equal to m infinity over 2, with a d actually because it's m infinity over 2 per each component. So this is a, now this is a closed equation for m infinity. Do you agree? So if I know m infinity, I can extract the noise. I extract r0 from this, it's not really probability, but from this thing. And then I do all the integrals and I get m infinity, so I can solve it.
Yes. The temperature we're using for the...
Oops. There is a beta missing, right? No, it's fine. Sorry, no, the beta is fine. The temperature...
Shouldn't be given by the variance of the fast, the noise of the fast part, or... Because you're solving that equation, which is the gradient plus noise.
Yes.
And the tempo comes from the variance of the noise.
Ah, yes, but the variance of the noise, everything is in equilibrium. So I raised it, but the variance of this is precisely the t times the kernel that I have here.
Okay.
So you have a friction here, and in the noise you have t times the same friction. And you have an mf here, times you have beta mf, and in the noise you have mf. So the correlation of the noise is t times the friction.
So
which is FDT.
Like being in contact with a thermal bath of temperature.
At equilibrium T. Yeah, so this was true from the beginning. I always had the same kernel in the bath and in the friction. By construction, because I started in equilibrium.
Okay.
Good. So we have this equation for the plateau. So now you can solve it, and you can see that above some density, you have a solution. So to see this a little bit better, okay, written like this is a bit of a nightmare because you have to integrate over 3 d-dimensional vectors, right? You have to integrate over r, over psi infinity, and over r0 in d-dimensions each, so it's going to be a bit complicated. So you can manipulate a little bit this equation
And you can express it in terms of the you can express it in terms of the mean square displacement plateau instead of the okay. So if you do this, you express everything in terms of, so you remember that d infinity was equal to 2d over beta square n infinity. So if you express everything in terms of d and you manipulate a little bit the equation, and I put in the Dropbox the calculation so you can check it. So you have to, sorry, so if you can show from here that m infinity is equal to zero is always a solution. So the liquid is always a solution. But if you assume that m infinity is different from zero, then you can manipulate as I wanted to say, and you get this equation, d over rho times vd. So vd is the volume of a unit sphere in the dimension, is going to be equal to minus d times d. So from now on, I will drop these infinity suffixes to avoid having all these infinities everywhere. I have it on the boat, but not, I don't want to have it everywhere on the blackboard. So the you don't have to confuse this with the diffusion constant. So the diffusion constant is going to be the calligraphic d. So this d is the long time limit of the mean square displacement in the glass. So I get this times integral between 0 and infinity dr times r to the d minus 1 times the log of a function q of d beta and r times the derivative of the same function q with respect to d. Okay, and this q of d beta and r is the convolution of the potential with a Gaussian. So it's some integral over u of e to the minus d u squared over d times square root of 2 pi. Sorry, maybe there is a 4. No, it's fine like this. 2 pi d over d to the power d times e to the minus beta v r plus u. So, okay, to go from here to here, it's a bit long, but you have it in the Dropbox. So, I want to call this object f1 of d and beta. So, why this is more convenient? Okay, first of all, because d is the physical thing you want to get, plateau of mean. But also because now this is only, you have to do two one-dimensional integrals. So, because this is a convolution, this is a d-dimensional convolution. But, so this is, the potential is spherical. So if you do the convolution of two spherical functions, the result is also a spherical function. And the convolution can be done by just one-dimensional integral. Either you move to Fourier space, or you use what are called bipolar coordinates. Anyway, so this is a 1D integral. You can write it as a 1D integral. And this, and since Q is a radial function, this is also a radial integral. Here R is not a vector anymore, it's a scalar. So you have to do two one-dimensional integrals, one to compute Q and the other to compute the other integral. And this is easy. You put this on Mathematica and you compute F. So once you do this, you can do it on your computer. What you get is a function like this. So f1 has this shape for standard potentials. So if you use for V some R spheres or Lennard-Jones or 1 over R to the 12 or something like that, you get something like this. If you start to do more complicated things, you can get 2 or more maxima. But let's taste the simpler case. So you have a maximum, it goes to zero at the boundaries, and you see that for a given temperature, what you have to solve is 1 over rho equal to, I mean, you have to find the solution, sorry, to solve for d, you have to solve that f of d is equal to 1 over rho times constants. So for a given density, if the density is large, 1 over d is small, and you have to find the solution, and you have two solutions, and I will show you later that the good one is the small one. So this is the physical one and this is the unphysical one, let's say. And if density is large, is small, if density is small, you don't have a solution. So what you get is exactly what Ludovic already showed you twice, once for the P-spin and twice on the beta lattice today, is an equation where you have a transition, and the transition that we're going to call dynamical glass transition is at the density rho d of beta. So this d is for the, okay. This is a dynamical transition and it's not the dimension. This is going to correspond to the max of a d of f1 of d and beta. Fine? So if you want to get the dynamical transition for your favorite potential at your favorite temperature, you compute this as f1, you get the maximum, and this will give you the glass, the density of the glass transition. So above this density, you have a glass. Below this density, you don't have any solution, which means that the only solution is the one with m equal to 0 and d formally equal to infinity. Okay. So if you do... Now we are in the position to take the limit of d going to infinity. So, I mean, we already took the limit of d to infinity implicitly, but we were always working with vectors. So now we can completely get rid of d. By the way, this is section 3.3.2 of the book, I forgot to say. So you can check, now you can take Mathematica, you can do this. You fix, for example, our spheres, you compute this thing, you compute the maximum, and you can increase the dimension. So the dimension is only here, and here, and so on. You increase dimension, and what you can see, so if you write things in terms of a packing fraction, so remember this is essentially the packing fraction, there is some L to the D missing, but you can scale everything. So what you see is that the dynamical transition for our spheres, so there is no beta in our spheres, the dynamical transition of our spheres is going to be given when D is large by D times some phi hat over 2 to the d, and this phi hat is equal to 4.8067, and you can compute it to all the numbers you want. So the important point is that so for our spheres, the dynamical glass transition will appear at densities, at packing fractions that scale in this way, and you remember that, so this means that phi bar, so we define this phi bar as 2 to the d times phi. And so this is going to be of order d. So you remember when we discussed the thermodynamics, I said, OK, the thermodynamics is trivial up to exponentially large values of phi bar in d. So we are still fully in the region where the thermodynamics is trivial. The convergence radius of the virial expansion is when this thing is order is 1. So we are above we are in the dangerous region where the virial expansion does not converge, but still we can resum it, we can say, okay, the thermodynamics is trivial, but there could be some singularity hidden in the exponentially small corrections, and this is exactly what's going on, okay? We have a dynamical singularity, but we don't see it into the thermodynamics, so I will come back on this. Anyway, the important point is that you should now just become a bit familiar, because I'm going to use this a lot. So there will be the true packing fraction, there will be phi bar is going to disappear, and we are going to focus on this phi hat, that is the scale where we have the glass. We will see that below this, I mean, if phi hat is 0, so if you are on phi bar of order 1, everything is trivial. I mean, the thermodynamics is trivial, but also the dynamics is just, the memory is going to be 0. So that it's really an ideal gas, both from the thermodynamic and dynamic point of view. So this is how I have to scale the packing fraction. And the other thing that is important is that you can see that the value of d, this is going to be the d dynamical, so the value of d at the critical point, and also at any point in the glass, is going to scale as, so there is an L squared for dimensional reason, d is an L squared displacement,
times delta over d. And delta is going to be of order 1. So this means that the mean square displacement in the glass, when d is large, goes to 0 as 1 over d. So this means that in the glass, in very large dimensions, in the glass particles move very, very little. They move by order 1 over d in units of their diameter. So everything, this is what I was saying in the first lecture in the thermodynamics, everything happens in a shell of width 1 over d around the contact between two particles. And also in the liquid phase, so I wrote you, so I said, okay, in the glass we have this, so this is d of t that goes to d, but in the liquid it will stay on the plateau and then it will diffuse. And you can show that at any density, diffusion will start at when d is still of order 1 over d. So it means that in large dimensions, you know that in three dimensions you have diffusion when particles move by 1/10 of the size. So you don't have to move by one particle size to diffuse, right? You diffuse much earlier. This is in 3D. If you go to 4D, it will be a bit less. If you go to 5D, it's even a bit less. And in infinite D, it's enough to move by 1 over D to be already in the diffusive regime. Okay, that's just scaling.
In terms of volume, that is a constant fraction.
Yes, because the volume grows like e to the d. Yes, yes.
Going to distance 1 over d.
You explore a finite volume around you.
It's twice your exclusive volume.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's a good point. And the last thing, the last scaling we need is, you remember I told you, even already in the thermodynamics, in order to have a good limit, we need to assume that the potential V of R is actually a function V bar of H, where R is L times 1 plus H over D. So we need this scaling. So if you want, we need these three scalings. And you can check that if you assume these three things and you plug this into the equation, you can take d to infinity. It's a very easy calculation that I'm not going to do, but because it's not very interesting. But you can scale everything, and you get a finite limit. And the equations in the finite limit look like this. You have 1 over phi hat equal to f1 of delta and beta. So you just have to replace d by delta, density by phi hat, and v by v bar, and f1 is the same as, so this is a calligraphic f, but I mean it's the same function essentially. It's going to be minus delta times the integral between minus infinity and infinity dh, e to the h, so this is the volume factor, and then you have log q of delta beta h times dq over d delta, and q, now it's explicitly a 1D integral, so it's going to be integral over z of e to the minus h minus z square divided by 2 delta divided by square root of 2 pi delta, so it's a Gaussian convoluted with e to the minus beta v bar of z plus delta over 2. Okay? So now you see here the dimension does not appear anymore. So we really got the limit d to infinity, and we just have 1d, one integral to do for q, one integral to do for f, and then we have to solve this. And as I said, for our spheres, we get phi hat equal to 4.8077. Okay. Now, the next thing I want to discuss yes.
You can use the growth to raise
it's bad. Yes, it's bad. Okay. Let me do this quickly because it's not very crucial for what we. But okay, the last thing I want to do is, so in section 3.3.3, I want to write the dynamical equations for d to infinity. So this is very easy. We have this equation for r. So you have, you remember the equation for r? It was something like this. So now this r is a vector, let me specify it. And as I said, you can do the same, you can inject your this scaling with d in this thing. So here, all these are vectors, but you can show that the motion, as I said at the beginning, the motion transverse to the direction of r. So you have r0, right? R of 0 is equal to r0. So you can, this is r of t. This is r of t. You can check that the direction of r will not move, essentially. On time scales of order 1, if the two particles start with a certain distance, this will stay. So the motion of the two particles is of order 1 over d. And so in the transverse directions, if you move by 1 over d in the transverse direction, you move by 1 over d squared in the longitudinal directions, and you can forget it. So the only relevant motion is in the direction of the vector r0. So if you project on that direction, and if you scale everything in this way, you can get an equation for h. So I don't do it, but I've read the result. So the result is you have an equation like this. This is going to be equal to t minus beta integral of some memory m, which is not exactly the same, times h dot of t prime, plus a noise, minus v prime of h of t. And this scaled friction is just the original friction multiplied by L square over 2d square. So you have to rescale the friction and you have to rescale the memory by the same factor. So this m like this is just m times L square over 2d square. And you get this equation for h. So now this is a one-dimensional equation for one single thing, which is the distance between the two particles. And you can, so the correlation of the noise is a 1D object, and now its correlation is going to be the one you expect. So it's going to be 2 xi t delta plus the m. And you can get an equation, the memory function is just phi hat over 2 times the integral between minus infinity and infinity dh0 e to the h0 minus beta v hat of h0 times the correlation of the force, which is just v prime of h0 times the average of v prime of h of t. So it's exactly the same equation, just written in terms of h. Okay? So the only reason I'm writing this is that this is what we are really solving, not the previous one. Because this one, you have to simulate a vector in d dimensions, which is complicated. And this one is equivalent, but it's 1D. Okay. Is there any question before I erase? Yes.
Until which time you can simulate the dynamics of this equation without taking into account the change of orientation of r?
On any finite time. So you can show that the derivative of r dot of r hat is of order 1 over d. So if time is finite, it will stay constant. It will move on times of order d, but you don't care because at times of order d you are already in the diffusive regime at any density, so nothing happens. So you have really a separation of time scales between the longitudinal motion and the movement of the orientation of the particles. Okay, the last thing I want to discuss before moving to the next part is the critical properties of this dynamical transition. So I think Ludovico already talked a little bit about it, but it's good to repeat it. So within this mean field theory, you get the same critical properties of MCT, of mode coupling theory. So what happens is when you are very close to the critical point, if you look to the mi squared displacement, so now this is scaled, but I mean it's the same. You can do it in terms of both. So you have a plateau, and what's going to happen is that you approach the plateau and then you leave the plateau and you diffuse. So this is in the liquid phase, but very close to the dynamical point, to the dynamical transition. What happens is you will approach the plateau as a power law, and you will leave the plateau as another power law, and at long times you are going to diffuse. Okay. And so if you want, when you are, so d of t, delta of t minus delta, actually, delta minus delta of t, when you approach the plateau, scales like t to the minus a. So if this is the plateau time, okay? So this is for t smaller than t plateau when you approach t plateau. And delta of t minus delta is t to the b at times larger than t plateau. And then you diffuse. So these two exponents, a and b, are called the MCT exponents, and they satisfy a relation, which is this, gamma squared, and this is also equal to gamma of 1 plus b squared divided by gamma of 1 plus 2b. So there is a parameter lambda that is called the mode coupling parameter that fixes these two exponents. So they are not independent, a and b, they are related by this. And the plateau time and the diffusion constant will both scale as.
Yes,
gamma is the Euler gamma function. Thank you. So the plateau time scales as 1 over the diffusion constant, and they scale as phi minus the dynamical point to the minus gamma. So the plateau time will diverge with gamma, and the diffusion will go to 0 with gamma. And gamma is just 1 over 2a plus 1 over 2b. So in all spheres, so if you know lambda, you know a, b, and gamma. So in all spheres, you have in all spheres in infinite dimensions, you have lambda equal to 0.7707. Then you have a equal to 0.324. We have b equal to 0.629, and you have gamma equal to 2.338, and something like that. So now, I just want to stress one thing. Deriving this directly from the equations I wrote, I think it's difficult. We didn't really try. So we took another route. I mean, so OK, MCT people are able to derive this. I mean, if you take the MCT equations or the p-spin equations, you can derive this. Looking, you do asymptotic developments around the plateau of the equations, but the equations are a bit simpler because the memory is a polynomial in terms of the correlation of delta. Here, the memory is a complicated function, so I think it's doable, but we didn't try. What we did is to take a slightly different route, so you can map the dynamical equation into replica equations that I will introduce later, and then you can show that these exponents are written in terms of some cumulant of replicas. So that's what we did in practice, just to prevent you that you will not find the dynamical calculation somewhere because it doesn't exist, but we are sure that it will work in this way. So there is a, so I mean I can give you references if you want to understand this part, but the important point I want to make is just that we can compute lambda for any potential and we can get results. So for our spheres we get these results. This is just to give you an idea. And these results for our spheres, I would say if you fit the mode coupling regime in dimensions 3, 4, 5, 6, the number is more or less, I mean the number especially for gamma is more or less this. Of course it depends on how you do the fit, but when increased dimension is easier because it's more power law. So it's not a crazy number, it's reasonable, okay? And the last thing is that about the critical properties is that you can introduce a chi4 function. So chi4 would be defined in this context as in this way. So where d hat is the mean square displacement, but without the average, just this. So this object here is the average of this over the dynamics. So if you take the average of the square of this, and you subtract and you take the connected part, and you multiply by n, you get the susceptibility, and I think Ludovic discussed it, and you can compute this thing, and what you find is that when phi, so when you are in the glass phase, the mean square displacement has a finite limit, and also chi4 has a finite limit, chi, and this will diverge as delta phi to the -1/2. So delta phi is the distance from the dynamical transition. So the plateau itself has a square root singularity, and then it jumps as in the Bethe lattice model that Ludovic discussed on the epispin. So the delta jumps from zero in the liquid to this value in the glass, and then it has a square root increase. But the susceptibility, the plateau of the susceptibility, increases, diverges as a with an exponent 1/2, and when you are in the liquid, then the long time limit of chi4 is trivial, it's constant. But if you measure this chi4 at the value of the plateau, then this will also diverge as delta phi to the -1/2 when you come from the liquid. And also you can also work out that there is a dynamical correlation length, and this will diverge as delta phi to the -1/4. So these are the mean field exponents, and they have been derived in many ways. There are works on mode coupling equation. I mean, you take the mode coupling equation, you show that this is the case, and this is work by Giulio, Jean-Philippe, and other people. There are works on the p-spin. There are and you can also derive it by this mapping on the replica equation. So it's, I think it's well understood that these are the mean field exponents and they are universal in all these problems. Okay, questions? Okay, so with this I will stop talking about the dynamics. So let me just make a summary of what I, how much time do I have? 30 minutes, perfect. Okay, so I will stop here with the dynamics. So just the summary up to this point is this one: the liquid thermodynamics is trivial. By trivial I mean that the g of r is just e to the -β v of r,
the reduced pressure is just 1 plus 5 bar over 2 times some function of beta and nothing else. So it's just the second virial contribution and so on. So yeah, I'm going to use phi hat from now on, so let's write it in this way. And 2, the liquid dynamics is not trivial. So this is in infinite dimensions. The liquid dynamics is not trivial, so we get a dynamical glass transition where the diffusion is completely arrested, and this happens at a value of phi hat of order 1 when d goes to infinity, and we have a mean square displacement of order 1 over d. Now you can say, okay, how is it possible that the dynamics is non-trivial when the thermodynamics is so trivial that there is nothing in the thermodynamics? So the next step is to try to get back to the thermodynamics and try to understand a little bit better what's going on from the thermodynamic point of view. Okay? So this, I wanted to start next week, but I cut a little bit on the dynamics and I will start now, so maybe we have a bit more time next week to do it slowly and carefully. So, what do we want to do? We want to go back to the thermodynamics. So now this is chapter 4 in the book. So this is the Franz Parisi method that Ludovic already introduced. And it's essentially the how to construct the thermodynamics of the glass. Okay, so before I do thermodynamics, let's rediscuss a little bit the dynamics, okay, quickly. But I want to introduce a small additional ingredient. So let me call distance or mean square displacement between two configurations x and y this object. Okay, so I have two configurations of the particles. I call it x and y. And I measure the mean square displacement between x and y. So what we have seen, so now suppose I extract y in equilibrium at some state point phi g tg. You will understand later why I'm calling it in this way, but for the moment I just extract y in equilibrium at this point, and then I run dynamics for x of t with x of 0 equal to y, but I run the dynamics at another state point, phi t. Okay? So you can do this in a numerical simulation. Camille, for example, is doing it. So you can say, okay, I start with an initial state that I have equilibrated here. Now, instantaneously, I change the temperature, I change the size of the particles, and I run the dynamics. So what's going to happen? So I can define, so suppose I start in a glass. So I start in equilibrium, but I start in equilibrium at densities bigger than the dynamical glass transition. So we know that the diffusion coefficient is 0 because the system is unable to diffuse away. So let's consider the limit of d of x of t and y. So this will be a constant. Let's call it dr or delta. I mean, now I'm back to d dimensions, but anyway, you can think it's delta. So this is what we just said, okay? But now I call it dr for a reason, which is that now let's consider another thing, the limit for tau to infinity of the limit for t to infinity of d of x of t plus tau x of t. And I will call it this d. Yes?
So n, big n is the number of particles, right?
Yes, I have n particles, but I'm in the thermodynamic limit, so n is going to infinity.
Okay. X and Y represent two different particles?
No, I have two configurations of the particles.
Okay.
And X and Y are the position of the same particle
the same
in the two conf-
okay.
in the two configurations.
Okay. That's it.
So I will extract y, so you can think to y as the initial condition for x. So in that case, this is precisely the mean square displacement, but then I want to use it in a more general way.
Yeah, indeed.
So I will have replicas, and this will be the distance between replicas. But so for the moment, this object is really the mean square displacement we discussed until 2 minutes ago. So the limit of this is dr, now I call it dr. And then I can say, okay, so this means I start in y, I move away. But I am in a glass, I'm assuming I'm in a glass, so I cannot move too far away, I will stay close to the initial point. I call it dr. Now I can say, okay, now I start in the glass, I move. So let's say I have my, this is phase space. I start in some point, I move away. So this is x of t. And this d is the distance between x of t and y in the space of all particle coordinates. And I can say, okay, now I take x of t, and then I move a bit more, and I have x of t plus tau. And I say, if t is very large, I will say, okay, maybe my particle has explored more or less all the space it can explore, because I know that this d will saturate. So at some point, I go far away, but I will not move too much far away from the initial point. And then I say, okay, now I have another, I move a bit more, quite a lot, but I stay in this thing, and I call d the distance between these two, and dr the distance between these two. Now I have a question for you. What happens if these two state points are the same? If I start in a state point and I run the dynamics at the same state point and I'm in the glass, what happens to d and dr? You don't speak.
They are equal,
exactly. So if I start in a state point and I run the dynamics at the same state point, then d is equal to dr. Why? Because the dynamics is stationary. I'm starting in equilibrium, I'm running dynamics in the same point. So d, this is the diffusion between time t and time zero. This is the diffusion between time t plus tau and time t, but it doesn't depend on t. So both functions are functions just of one time, which is the difference. And if I send this difference to infinity, I get the same. So if I start in a point and I stay in the same point, these two things are identical, and this will be the plateau that I was discussing up to 5 minutes ago. But now I want to be a little bit more general. So I want to consider a situation where I can start in a glass, but I want to explore this glass basin at a different temperature or density. Just to, because, I mean, we're going to use it later, so. And in that case, d and dr are not the same, because dr is the typical distance between a point in the glass basin and the initial point. And d is the typical distance between two configurations that are sampling this glass. Let's say independently, okay? I mean, they could be equal, but they don't need to be equal. There is no reason for them to be equal. Now, good. So I will assume now three things, and then I will come back on this, because the problem is, you see that y is the reference state, and in principle, these two things depend on y, right? So it could be that if I, because these are the distance in this glass, and this glass was selected by this y. If I now take another y that is somewhere else in the space, maybe the glass is different, it has a different size, and these things could depend on y. So I will assume that this is not the case. So I will assume.
Can I ask you about how do you start the process? Because you increase the density. So you are increasing the energy. In the case of our sphere, it's not clear that you can increase the density.
Yes, I agree. So let's suppose for the moment that the potential is soft. In our spheres, I will come back on this, but one important point on the density is that I want to compare configurations. So I want the particles to be in the same volume and with the same number of particles. So I will, when I say I will change density, there is always a length scale in the potential, so I will change this length scale, so that the particle size, which is the same. So if I think towards spheres, I will change a little bit the size of the spheres. But yes, I agree. If I start in a state and instantaneously I grow all the particles and they are hard, there is a risk that I run into problems. So it's give me a second. So three assumptions. So the first assumption, essentially, these three assumptions amount to say that there is no phase transition happening in the glass when I move from this initial state to the final state. But we will come back on this. But for the moment, the assumptions are this. The first assumption is that the limit for t to infinity of d of x of t and x of t plus tau exists and is a function of tau. Okay. So I'm saying at long times the dynamics become stationary. So a correlation function between time t and time t plus tau does not depend anymore on t. This limit could not exist. For example, when you do aging in glasses, you keep aging and this limit does not exist. So I'm assuming it exists. I'm also assuming that this thing has a finite limit because I'm in a glass, but this is already there. So the second thing, I will assume that d of d and dr concentrate over y. So the fluctuations of these two things, so these are intensive objects, right? They are averages over the system divided by n. So I will assume that when d and dr, when n goes to infinity, the fluctuations of these two things over y become very small, of the order of 1 over square root of n, as usual. But this is not guaranteed. I mean, there could be a problem if there is a phase transition. And then more or less the same assumption as 1, but just to state it more explicitly, that the long time properties do not depend on the history. So what I mean is precisely the question of Federico. If I bring my system from the initial state to the final state using, not instantaneously, but doing something more like slowly or I can change the temperature in some way slowly, or I can increase the density slowly to prevent that. This will not affect the long times. So these functions. It's more or less the same as 1, but so this means that I can, if I have hard spheres, I don't have to think about doing it instantaneously. I can do it slowly, but it's fine. So I'm assuming that this glass is essentially an ergodic state, and I can sample, if I remain confined in this part, but I explore it ergodically. So the way the short time dynamics doesn't really matter on how I explore it at long times. Is this fine? Okay. So under these assumptions, what I am going to do, I'm going to try to do, is to write a measure for x at long times. So what is the, how, what can I say on x at long times? When you do equilibrium stat mech, you say, okay, when the system is in equilibrium, it will try to explore all the phase space that is available at a given energy. So what I want to do in normal equilibrium is to maximize the entropy at constant energy. Right? So I take a distribution, P of x, over the phase space. I maximize the entropy of P of x subject to the constraint that the energy should be constant. And you know that this implies that P of x is the Boltzmann distribution with beta being a Lagrange parameter conjugated to the energy. Okay, so this is related to the large deviations we were discussing yesterday night, right? Fine, so I want to do exactly the same. I want to say, okay, I don't know much of the dynamics of x of t. I mean, I could solve the dynamics, but it's complicated. I want to simplify the problem. So I can say, okay, x of t is going to explore phase space. But I know that at long times, I will maybe rewrite it here. I know that at long times, the distance between x of t and y is not going to diverge. So x will remain confined in a kind of ball around y. So for the glass, what I'm going to assume, but now this is really an assumption, that I can maximize the entropy of x subject to constant energy and constant dr. Okay? So I conjecture that the long time probability distribution of x is going to be the one that maximizes the entropy under these two constraints. And if I do that, then the probability of x, now I will write it, let me write it properly. So the energy, I mean, the momenta are always going to be in equilibrium, so I'm doing classical systems, the momenta will decouple and they are Maxwellian and I don't care about the momenta, okay? So I don't have to fix the, I just look at the configuration part. So the probability of x at constant density, temperature, and y, and dr, what is this? This is going to be exponential of minus beta v of x. So this is the constant energy requirement. I have to fix a temperature to match the. And then I will put here minus lambda times d of x and y, right? If I want to fix d, I have to introduce another Lagrange parameter, I call it lambda, that will fix, and I will fix lambda in such a way that the distance is the one I want. Okay, this is not, I mean, it can be done in this way, but it's not fully practical. So you know that in any case, it's equivalent, in the thermodynamic limit, it's equivalent to do this or to just put a delta function. So I will use ensemble equivalence to say, okay, this is, I can put here a delta function directly without going through the Lagrange parameter. It's the same. So I will say that this is the distribution of x at long times, and then I have to normalize it. So the normalization will depend on density and temperature at the new state point, the initial state, and dr. Okay? And now, so z is going to be, this is the partition function for x. So for the moment, y is really still to be fixed. And so this will be the integral over x of the numerator. And I will introduce now a free energy of the glass. So the free energy of the glass is just going to be Fg of phi t given y and dr, and it will be minus t over n times the logarithm of z of the same arguments. Is this fine? So again, I'm selecting some y from equilibrium at some state point, and we'll come back to this. And I'm assuming that x is going to maximize its entropy at constant distance. So I have y and the distance from y as parameters that I still have to fix. And then I have phi and t. So t is the one that appears here, and phi is the density. If you want, it's encoded in the potential. So the potential will have a length scale, and the length scale will fix the density. And this is the free energy of my glass. So what can I do now? I mean, now I have two problems. The first problem is that computing this is a nightmare, because y is, you have this field, if you want, you have y, you have the particles of y, so y1, y2, and then you have this thing here that is, and then you have x, and x is attached, I mean, it's attached to y, right? So you have x3, x2, x1, and there is a spring essentially that is connecting x to y. So translational invariance now is completely broken because y is spinning the particles of x. So computing this is a nightmare. You have to do some kind of virial expansion in system with no translational invariance. It's not possible. The second thing is that probably is not needed because I don't want to do this calculation for each y. So I will assume, as I assume here, that the fluctuations of this thing over y concentrate. So this is called self-averaging, and it has been evoked yesterday. So I will assume that this thing essentially does not depend on y. And so I'm going to introduce a glass free energy of phi t and phi g tg and delta and dr or delta r, which is just the average of this object over y. Okay, and the assumption is that when in the thermodynamic limit, with very large probability, this one and this one will be the same. The fluctuations of this one are going to be of order 1 over square root of n. It's an assumption. But it's essentially this assumption, that all the macroscopic observables concentrate. So what is this? Now I should write it somewhere. So I can erase the max entropy. So what is this Fg? Now it's easy to write it. So Fg of phi g, just 1 second, phi t and dr, yes.
Constraining the system like canonically before, instead of that with the exponential, so leads to a really different result for the free energy. I mean, it's not a good approximation. Instead of constraining it tightly with a delta, so like.
But they are Legendre transform one of the other.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like if you use the macrocanonical ensemble, you get the entropy as a function of energy.
Yeah.
If you use the canonical ensemble, you get the free energy as a function of temperature, but you can reconstruct one from the other.
It's not easy to work with that yet one.
It's doable, but it's... Yeah, I could do it. I could do it with the exponential of minus lambda and then do a Legendre transform, and I would get the same result.
Yeah. Okay.
You will see in a second why I or maybe next week, why I prefer the delta.
Okay.
Just, but yes, I could do it with lambda and then do the Legendre transform. So, okay, so what is this? This is just minus t over n. Then I have to integrate over y, because I want to average over y. What is the distribution of y? I have exponential of minus beta g times vg of y, divided by z of phi g and tg. So this beta g and phi g are the temperature and density of the reference state. And this, I put a g to the v to stress that in v there is a length scale that I use to fix the density. And then I have to average the log. So I have log of this z that I wrote here. So this is integral over x of e to the minus beta v of x times delta of dr minus d of x and y. Okay, so this is my glass free energy that I averaged over the initial state. So, now, I want to stress one thing, which is that I said at the beginning, when I was in the first lecture, I said, okay, I can construct this free energy of rho of x, and I can say, okay, if rho of x is uniform, I'm in a liquid or in a gas. If rho of x is periodic, I am in a crystal. And I said, okay, if rho is amorphous, I'm in a glass. And I said, okay, what does it mean, amorphous? It's not clear what is, I mean, amorphous is something that is not periodic, maybe, but it could be quasi-periodic,
there could be, it maybe it doesn't look periodic, but there is some hidden periodicity. So there is a huge literature on what, on defining the notion of amorphous, and my personal point of view is that in the end you don't really find a satisfactory definition of disordered, of what you mean by disordered. So there are limits in which you can say, for example, jamming, you can say, okay, when I take a jammed state, this is, I do it very quickly, so it's fully disordered. So it's the anti-crystal, as Andrea said. So in some limits you can say things, but in general it's hard to say what is an amorphous state. So this is a precise definition of an amorphous state. So I'm saying an amorphous state is something which is the neighborhood, let's say, vibrations around a reference configuration that I take from the liquid. Okay? So I take a liquid, I increase density. At some point, I get stuck, and so I get stuck around the typical liquid configuration, and we think to liquids as disordered objects. So this is a precise definition of an amorphous state. Of course, it's not the full story. I mean, there could be other amorphous states prepared in different ways. But if you're thinking to preparing a glass as cooling from a liquid, I think that's a reasonable and precise mathematical definition of what you mean by a glass. Okay, this is a remark. The other remark is, okay, we still have a problem. The problem is this dr. What is the value of dr? So, okay, one could say, okay, I don't know the value of dr. So I could say, okay, I solve the dynamics, I extract dr, and then I say, okay, then I know dr from dynamics, and I use the dr that I got from dynamics to as an input for this free energy.
So here you assume that all the states of this dr from the starting point are accessible by the dynamics, right?
Yes.
Is it true? Because if d is much smaller than dr, if the d of the...
No, sorry. No, what I'm assuming is that if I take an equilibrated state inside this glass, its distance from y concentrates around dr.
Yeah, but you count all states at distance dr.
You don't. I think two dimensions is misleading. Phase space is very. So you can imagine that you concentrate at the distance dr, but the volume I don't know how to draw it, but you can imagine that you have states at distance dr from a reference state, that and this dr concentrates around the mean, but you cannot explore all of the states around dr. So we're going to see that the typical distance d between two states inside the glass is different from dr. So, I mean, it's geometry in very, very, very large dimensions. We can think about it and try to come up with some representation, but I don't have much intuition on geometry in large dimensions. So okay, I could take this dr from dynamics, but this would not be very satisfactory because I wanted to get rid of dynamics. So so what can I do? What I can do is to plot this thing as a function of dr. So if I fix an initial state that is in the glass phase, in the dynamically arrested phase in equilibrium, and I follow it at some density and temperature that are not too different, and we will come back on that, but this f looks like this. So if I plot this fg, which is called the Franz Parisi potential, and Ludovico already plotted it as a function of q, so q was the overlap, so this is distance, so it's a bit different, but it's the same kind of plot. What I will see is something like this. Okay? So this is the shape. We are going to compute this explicitly, and you will be able to do this plot on your computer. But for the moment, you can trust me. If you do this calculation, you get something like this. So you have a local minimum, and then you have another minimum. So in Ludovic notation, Q was the overlap between two things, and it was normalized to be one for when the two configurations are identical, and zero when they are very different. So this would be Q equal to one. In Ludovic notation, this would be Q equal to zero. So one, overlap one means zero distance, and overlap zero means infinite distance. So this is the liquid. So if
if you don't, I mean, if you send dr to infinity, essentially you can explore all of phase space, and you get the liquid. But you have a local minimum.
So you can say, okay, maybe this is the glass.
Because what we know is that in equilibrium, systems tend to minimize the free energy. So here we have a local minimum, and we could say, okay, maybe this local minimum describes the glass. So I can try to fix dr in this way. I fix dr by minimizing the Franz Parisi. And I don't know if it's going to work. It's an assumption. So we will have to check, and we will check that the dr that we get in this way is exactly the one that we get from the dynamics. And then we know that this method works. So I think I'm more or less out of time. So let's conclude. So what we're going to do next time, let me say just one last thing. So we are going to check that this is correct. So we are going to compute this object in infinite dimensions, and we are going to check that the minimum for dr is exactly the value that we computed today from dynamics. And the other thing is how we are going to do that. So this is important. And the point is that you see now why is a quenched disorder for x. So we always say, okay, but glasses have no quenched disorder, so why you want to use spin glass methods in glasses? So this was the main objection to when Kirkpatrick, Tirumalai, and Volnes proposed that the infinite dimensional theory of glasses was the same as the solution of p-spin models. And people say, okay, but in glasses you don't have the jij, so what is the quenched disorder in glasses? And here you understand what it is. It's just the reference configuration. So in a glass, when you cool, you get stuck. And so you are forced to stay in a state. And this state is specified by some y. And this y is essentially is the quenched disorder. So that was realized by several people, shortly after Kirkpatrick, Tirumalai, and Volnes proposed their conjecture. Monasson, Franz Parisi, even there is even a paper by Tirumalai and Volnes where they propose something like that. So, I mean, in the end, I think this is the best formalization of the idea, but you can do it in many ways. And here you explicitly see that you have the free energy of x that contains y as a quenched disorder, and y is being averaged over a distribution. So you could imagine, I said, okay, here you can describe glasses that fall out of equilibrium at phi g and tg, and then you follow them out of equilibrium at t and phi. You could imagine to have a different distribution for y. If you think that you are preparing your glass by a different protocol that produces configurations with some probability, you can replace this by some p of y that you specify in some way. And if you are able to do this calculation, you could describe glasses prepared by this protocol. So really the idea is to think glasses are essentially vibrations around structures, and these structures are extracted by some probability, and there is concentration around the mean over the probability of y. And provided you this applies, you can think in this way, and you can use spin glass methods. So what we are going to do is to use the replica method to take care of this average of the log, and to make the problem tractable, and then we'll take the infinite dimensional limit and we will get the result. So I think I can stop here. So the plan for next week is just to do this in the first lecture, and then we can move to other, we can do the Monasson calculation, and then we can look at Gardner. Yes, yes. The lambda is the epsilon coupling. Okay. So it's just, I mean, you do it in Q, and here it's better to do it in delta, but it's really the same idea. I could have called it epsilon maybe, but...
Okay.
So you get the first order transition, and then it ends up at the Gauss. I mean, it's exactly that.
You say get d of r from the dynamics.
Sorry. No, sorry.
D of r from the dynamics. Do you mean checking its numerical calculations or the d of r that we calculated earlier, which is
the one we calculated? So I could say okay, I take the dynamical equations, I solve them, I get the plateau, and I take this plateau as input for this free energy. But the point is, this would be a way to get the free energy of a glass, if you want a free energy. So from the dynamics, you don't get the free energy. But it's not very satisfactory because, I mean, the point of all this is to be able to recover the results of the dynamics without solving the dynamics, which is much more... So we will see that in the end, we will end up with very simple equations that you can solve on your laptop in a few seconds. While solving the dynamical equations, you can ask Alessandro's some work.
Right.
Okay.
Is this something more appropriate in that dimension than in the dimension? Because it seems to me like in, you know, the standard case, that would be one of the characteristic properties of glasses would be that the quantum properties do depend on this.
Okay, it depends on the regime in which you are. So in finite dimensions, I draw this thing in this way, but actually, so if you are in finite dimensions, this dr should better be a dr of x. You should have a special dependent profile of overlap.
Yeah.
And then you can see that if you allow dr to depend on space, you will nucleate. So in finite d, you are going to nucleate from here to the liquid. So your glass will become unstable, so it's just a metastable state. And so there is a lot of work. I mean, Chiara did a lot of work on this. Benjamin is working on this. So this thing will become essentially convex once you allow dr to fluctuate. So you will have a Maxwell construction. So the glass is going to be a metastable state with finite lifetime. But as we were discussing yesterday, if the lifetime is much longer than your experimental time, then you can think that this will not happen and this is a good description. So it depends. If you are doing, for example, aging, so if you start at high temperature and you quench very quickly, you are going to end up with very unstable states that have a short lifetime, and you're going to jump to stay more stable, more stable, more stable, and you cannot describe that process in these terms. But if you think that you go very slowly, that's what I was saying yesterday, you go very slowly up to some point, so you are in a very good equilibrium, the lifetime of your relaxation time is very large, and now you start to compress a bit faster, then the time to relax is going to be essentially infinite on your time scale, and then you can think that this is a good description. So it's a problem of time scales. Okay?
So in the integral dy, is the complexity low tgs inside this integral?
No, the complexity, I will come back later to the complexity.
But
so
you take into account of y1, y2 as you go. So that is not where the complexity comes from.
The complexity will be this difference. So the point is now what we are trying to do is to compute the free energy of the glass, of one glass, and then if you say okay, I take the free energy of the liquid and I remove the free energy of one glass, what remains is the entropy of how many glasses I have.
Okay.
So it's going to be this difference. But this is in two lectures. I will come back to this.
Okay, so if there are no other questions, thank you again.